We live in a three-dimensional world. If I start talking about geometry in the fourth dimension, most people seem not to care, at least beyond it being a fun hypothetical. In fact, some of the most important facts in math use not just four dimensions, but infinitely many. My name is Andrew, and I'm a math PhD student. Today we're going to be talking about applications of infinite dimensional math. Before we get all the way to infinite dimensions, let's start by understanding finite dimensions. Roughly speaking, an object is n-dimensional if it takes n numbers to describe a point in it. So, for example, this square is two-dimensional because it takes two numbers, the x and the y coordinate. Similarly, this cube is three-dimensional because this time it takes three numbers, the x, y, and z coordinate. Visualizing a point inside a cube is easy enough. Just put a point inside a cube. Unfortunately, we're in trouble when it comes to four dimensions, because I don't know about you, but I've never seen a four-dimensional hypercube. But I can teach you how to think about a point in a 4D hypercube, even if you can't see it. Simply put, our hypercube is just all lists of four numbers, each between 0 and 1. So I can just put down four sliders, each going between 0 and 1, and pick a point in each slider. That is a point in a 4D hypercube. Once you realize that a point in n dimensions is just a list of n numbers, you start to see high-dimensional objects all over the place. I can think of a bunch of numbers associated to me. Height, age, weight, credit card number. So, in a sense, these aspects of who I am live in high-dimensional space. The modern world loves data. And data analysis works all the time in thousands of dimensions, if not more. But where this perspective really shines is when we get to infinite dimensions. You might think that to get to infinite dimensions, you just don't stop listing numbers. And you'd be right. An infinite sequence of real numbers lives in infinite dimensional space. But actually, anything with an infinite number of parameters lives in infinite dimensional space. Instead of taking a sequence of real numbers, I'm going to pick a number for each number in between 0 and 1. Here is a point in an infinite dimensional cube, or perhaps more familiarly, it's a function with input and output in the interval 0, 1. This is the real power of infinite dimensional space. It can be a space where the points themselves are functions. Beyond just a cool new way to think about functions, this perspective is genuinely useful for solving problems. To show an example, we're going to focus on this complicated-looking equation. What we claim is that there's a unique continuous function that satisfies this equation whose domain is the interval 0, 1. In other words, we claim that this equation is enough to implicitly define f. Actually finding a formula for f is unfortunately going to be impossible, although you're free to waste your time if you want. Instead, we're going to use infinite dimensional math to show both that there exists a solution and how to approximate it. In order to do this, we're going to use a powerful tool called the Banach fixed point theorem. I'm going to give a brief overview of this theorem, but if you want to see more details, I'll leave some links in the description. As the name might suggest, this theorem is about fixed points. A fixed point of a transformation t is a point that doesn't change when you apply t. For example, if we take t of x equals x squared, 1 is a fixed point of t because t of 1 equals 1. The Banach fixed point theorem is about a special type of transformation that brings points closer together called a contraction. A transformation t is called a contraction if for any two points x and y, t of x and t of y get closer together by some constant factor q. The theorem tells us that every contraction has a unique fixed point. And what's even better is that it tells us how to find the fixed point. If you start with any point and just repeatedly apply t, this will converge to the fixed point. Hey, this is Andrew from the future. I'm editing right now, and I realized I forgot to mention a pretty important assumption about the Banach fixed point theorem. The space we're working with has to be what's called complete. It's a little bit of a technical property, but I'll leave some links in the description if you're interested. Anytime we use the theorem today, our space is complete, so you don't have to worry about it. Let's look at an example. Define t of x equals 2 plus x over 3. For a pair of points x and y, the distance between t of x and t of y is the absolute value of x minus y over 3, which is less than the distance between x and y by a factor of a third. What this tells us is that t is a contraction, and if we apply it to, say, 1 over and over again, we seem to be converging on 3. And yeah, t of 3 equals 3. What's really neat about this theorem is that it works in any dimension, and for any sensible way of measuring distances. Now let's talk about the infinite dimensional space of continuous functions whose domain is the interval 0, 1. The notation for this space is C0, 1, and remember, the points inside are functions. So in order to hope to apply the Banach fixed point theorem, we need a way of measuring the distance between continuous functions. Thankfully, there are tons of ways of measuring the distance between continuous functions. A really nice one for our purposes is called the L-infinity distance. Here, the distance between two functions is just the maximum vertical distance between their graphs. And conveniently, there's a really nice formula for this. It's just the max absolute value of f minus g of x. Importantly, we're focusing just on the interval 0, 1. Otherwise, this distance might not really make sense because it could blow up to infinity. Let's define a transformation t on the space of continuous functions. Like any transformation, t is going to take in a point and give back a point. But remember, in this infinite dimensional space, our points are functions. So t is going to take a function as input and return a function as output. Okay, define t by this formula. Let's look at an example. If we input this function, we get this other function as output. It might seem weird to have a function be inputting and outputting functions, but there's a good chance you've seen something along these lines already. The derivative is something that takes in a function as input and returns another function as output. Functions of this type are usually called higher order functions or operators. Okay, let's get back to the problem at hand. A fixed point of t would be a function such that for all x, f of x is equal to t of f of x. And that's the same as saying that f satisfies the equation that we're trying to solve. What I claim is that t is a contraction on the space C0, 1. Let's prove it. Let f and g be continuous functions on the interval 0, 1. We claim that t brings f and g closer together by at least a factor of a half. Okay, well, for any x, the absolute value of t of f of x minus t of g of x is a half times the absolute value of f of x squared minus g of x squared. But since the distance between f and g is the max distance of their absolute values, this is at most half the distance between f and g. And since this was true for any x, the max distance between t of f and t of g is at most a half the distance between f and g. For example, the distance between x squared and sine of x is about 0.2, but after applying t, we get a distance of about 0.1. So now we know that t is a contraction, and then by the Banach fixed point theorem, it has a unique fixed point. And the f, that's that fixed point, is the unique solution to our equation. The proof kind of works like magic, and it really does rely on using infinite dimensional math. And then the other great part about the Banach fixed point theorem is it tells us how to find the function that solves this equation. Start with any continuous function and repeatedly apply t. Each time we apply t, we get closer and closer to the answer. I think it's kind of beautiful to watch a function converge to the answer, and we end up with some horrifying function we could never hope to find a formula for. And what's great is we can approximate it as close as we want. It feels like a life lesson to me. If at first you don't succeed, try again. Before I end, I want to mention that this is just one application of infinite dimensional spaces. They show up in signal processing, differential equations, quantum mechanics, and machine learning, just to name a few. Thanks a lot for watching, and if you found this interesting, please consider subscribing. I'm always looking for new video ideas, and if you have any suggestions, leave them in the comments.